Hey guys and girls, my name's Dan, welcome back to The Forge. In today's episode of Trust Me, I'm a Blacksmith, I am going to be doing a video where we talk all about recycled metals, how to get hold of them, where to find them and what to do with them once you've got your greasy little mitts on them.
We interrupt your normal TMIB viewing with these important announcements.
So, thought you might start messing around with some of that recycled material? Seen those clever chaps at TMIB doing it, haven't you? But you don't know where to start, do you, silly boy? Luckily, TMIB have got just the answer. First thing we're going to need to do is get some material. But you haven't got a clue where to start looking, have you? Would you like some tips and advice? Well, just in luck, because I know just the place. For small items like coil springs and small leaf springs, why not try a local scrapyard or breaker's yard? But if you're looking for something bigger like this forklift truck tine, or even drive shafts, why not try a local plant engineering or manufacturing company? You'll find these in readily available amounts, especially if the old boys fix them up good. Cor, blimey, that's a big boy you've got there, isn't it? Where'd you find such a whopper?
Okay, so a collection here of medium carbon steels, ranging up into the slightly higher end carbon steels. Everything between about 0.4% up to about 6% here. We got a coil spring out of a car. This was found by the side of the road. A leaf spring out of a truck. This was given to me recently. These forklift truck tines I bought. And then this drive shaft was here on the farm, but it came out of a machine. So what you're looking for are steels that do jobs, but they have to do hard jobs. Drive shafts, for example, have to take torsional loads. Springs, they're under tension. Forks as well, forklift truck tines, they need to be lifting up big weights. I'm using quite large tines here. Everything here is quite big. I have the ability to process it. But smaller drive shafts can be anything from an inch in diameter all the way up to, this is over 2 inches, 2 inches and an eighth. So you've basically got varying sizes of these materials available all the time. This is out of a common everyday car that you'd see mooching about. So back to the infomercial.
And some things to remember when looking through that scrap metal. If it's got a spline, you're fine. If it's a spring, it's a win. Now let's talk about butchering the beast. How to dissect your tine if you find one. This piece here is called the tine or the tip, sometimes referred to as the fork. It's pointy and tapered in length, varying from different tine to tine. This here is the heel. You can guarantee that this part is the bit that's buggered. You know that this bit's done in because it's normally worn away. And it's not very valuable if you're going to chop these sections up. Here we come to the saddle. The saddle is pretty much the best part. And these are the yokes or the hooks. This holds it to the machine. If you're careful, you'll be able to find yourself and locate some serial numbers. Serial numbers like this can tell you lots about the material it is made of and who made it. If you're lucky, you'll find this information on springs and drive shafts as well.
Okay, so a lot of steels have jobs and they work in industry, and there are rules and laws, especially in Europe, that relate to those products. And if an object like a tine is doing lifting, it comes under lifting regulations in the UK or Europe, at least anyway, and it has to have a number on it. And these numbers are great because we can use those to identify who made it, where it came from, and what it's made of. And then that way we can then find data sheets, and then we can use those data sheets to work out how to heat treat and turn these products into other products, basically. So on this one here, it says a serial number, which is there might relate to a date. Then it says France, then it said it was made for Volvo, and then it has another serial number following it. This spring has basically just told us what it's made of. We might have to do a bit of digging. It might be a bit hard to find all of the information, but we should be able to find out basically where this product came from and what it's doing. Okay. The reason they do it is if there was an accident and it's due to a fault in the material, then basically they can trace it back to that product.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. Hang on a second, mister. What do you think you're doing? You can't go cutting up material like this without any safety equipment on now, can we? We need to wear correct PPE. Let's start with the respirator. Some of these chrome alloys are a bit nasty on the old lungs, you know. And whilst you're at it, why not pop on a pair of safety glasses? We wouldn't want something going in those pretty little peepers, would we? Now, ears as well, boy. Otherwise you won't hear my beautiful voice whilst I'm lecturing you about the finer points of health and safety. Now that's better. Now get cutting. After all of that chop-foolery, you deserve a rest, old bean. Let's get the other Dan to take over from here.
I've chopped up the tine now, and I'm just quickly going to talk about how to sort of methodically go about it. The fork, or the tine end, the tapers, can be quite thin, and you basically just want to cut that bit off completely to start with. It's the easiest bit to chop up. And if you are going to draw out any sections, you might want to draw it out of this if you don't have a power hammer or you've got a smaller power hammer. What I tend to do is I tend to cut it into blocks that are about 4 inches by whatever the thickness is and whatever the width is. So we tend to cut them up into chunks and then reforge them down into section. We're going to do some of that in just a section. Second, I know a lot of people at home can't do that. I'll bring you a bit closer for this bit because this bit's quite complicated. Okay, and on the heel, this is it normally gets wasted. I normally cut across here and across here on the heel, but I've started, because I need the material basically, I've started cutting straight across the bottom of the heel in either one of the planes and then chopping a piece off and then drawing that out under the hammer. This piece here will have been worn away on the back of the heel, so this material tends to be a funny size and shape, so it's not great for drawing out into material. It's good for odds and sods though, so if you have, like I said, got a power hammer all the time to draw it out, it's not so much of a big deal, but you'll find that this section here is thinner here than it is here, and then again, this was the same thickness as this in a previous life, so it's not quite the same anymore. You can see it's lost a bit of material. Don't know if you can see that at all, actually. Right, and then the other thing that you want to do is, I don't bother with the top yoke. I only bother cutting off the bottom yoke. Gives me another couple of inches there to scavenge out of the tine. But just cut through the back of the yoke. So cut the heel off, whichever way you're going to profile it. Cut the heel off and chop it up that way with an angle grinder. For me, in the forge, everything gets processed out of these large blocks. Chop it up into 10 large blocks, and then go in the gas forge, and then they get reforged down into whatever stock we need. We can do that just now. But if you're at home, the saddle, the back of the tine, the piece that rests up against the forklift truck, and this tip here are probably the most useful bits for you at home, because the taper on these tines is naturally already adrift. So if you want to make hammer eye drifts, you've got a couple here, and some parts for axes and punches, so this profile is quite good for that. And then also this piece here is relatively square, so this side here and this side here tend to be parallel, and these sides tend to be relatively flat. So whatever this thickness is here, if you measure across and cut that out, with an angle grinder it's difficult, I understand that. But if you can cut that out relatively straight, take your time, you've got yourself a hammer blank. The blanks on this would be quite long, so you might want to cut those down as you go along as well, or even half them and make slightly smaller hammers. But that's what I used to do. I don't do that anymore, we've got the power hammer now. Makes life a little bit easier. But it's definitely a way that you can make the most out of these tines.
So whilst Dan here has a good time having a bit of bang bang with his metal, let's have a quick chat about what it is that makes forklift truck tine ideal for blacksmithing tooling. For starters, it's made of 4140, sometimes it's made of 1045. Both these materials make wonderful additions to tooling. You can make everything from tongs to hammers with the old boys. The other thing is, a pair of forklift truck tines will literally supply you with enough material to make all the tools you will ever need in your forge in a lifetime. And they'll last a lifetime too.
And now, for a word from our sponsors.
If it's starting a hard day, or finishing a long one. If it's hunger you gotta fix, we forge just the meal for you. Herefordshire ground beef patties cooked on an open roaring forge. Made just to do two things. Fill you up and hurt your gut. And if you don't think Dan liked them, he did, because we paid him.
Thank you so much for joining me. Hopefully this video was useful and a little bit of fun as well. I tried to mix it up a little bit with this video. I've done something like this before in the tomahawk or the toilet hawk video, where I made a tomahawk out of a railroad spike and then put a toilet roll holder on it. I'll leave a link to that video somewhere, probably at the end of this one. But this is just me having a bit of fun and messing around and just enjoying myself, really. So hopefully you enjoyed it. So I get asked questions all the time on Instagram, and this is a very common one. If I've got forklift truck tines, what do I do with them? I'm just going to run over some of the things that have been asked recently about tines. I hope this is useful information, and I hope that people at home have got something out of this video, because, again, I've enjoyed making it. It's been a bit of a giggle, hopefully there was some information here that was useful, at least. The biggest question I get asked about tine is how to, you know, chop it up, how to get stuff out of it, and also, do I need to anneal it before I start doing that process? Firstly, if you've got a bandsaw and you can get the tine in the bandsaw, I would recommend chopping it up a couple of times, like I showed in the video, in order to start getting stuff into the bandsaw. But if you can get it in there and you've got a good blade, I find more often than not you can cut them. However, if you're attempting to process the entire tine using one bandsaw blade, I've never had any luck doing that. I've attempted it, but you get like 5 or 6 cuts, and then the blade starts to dull, and then you start to lose the edge that you may have had. The saddle, or the back of the tine, the upright bit that's an even cross section all the way down, it's not the pointy bit, the actual tine or the fork, that itself is often quite soft. I tend to not have many issues with that bit necessarily. The heat affected areas in the weld can cause problems, but I tend not to have too many problems there. So if you do have a bandsaw, you can fit it in, and it's like one of the 4 inches by 1.5 inches, or 100mm by 40mm, you'll find that you can get most of your blanks out of that bit, and you won't wreck your blade too much. You will wreck it. It's a hard steel, but I tend to find that you can get away with it. But for me, I just chop it up using the angle grinder now. We don't even bother sticking it in the saw. We have the ability to do it. When the material's been forged and it's allowed to normalise, basically I forge it, reheat. Sometimes I reheat, or I'll cut it up into blocks and then reheat it. But I tend to find that the normalisation process of just allowing it to cool in the atmosphere works perfectly well. The stuff nice and soft anyway, and it's not heat treated. So for me personally, that's what I do. I don't tend to worry about it. But the other thing you could try is gas cutting. Okay, gas cutting is another way you can cut these up. And I think large recycling plants or scrap metal yards, they tend to gas cut these components up. Now, that's gonna leave you a nasty edge. It's gonna leave a lot of work to sort of tidy that up. So it's 6 of 1, half a dozen of the other. Do you spend a bit of time cutting it out with an angle grinder, then forging it? Do you spend a bit of time cutting it out with an angle grinder, trying to be really tidy with that angle grinder, and then making it into the objects you want? Do you risk or pay out for bandsaw blades, or are you just gonna gas cut it and then clean up those edges, forge it, whatever? There's no real, if you're gonna recycle, there's no real shortcuts. What you've gotta do is you've gotta spend that time chopping that thing up and then turning it into the object that you want. That's the cost. That's where the you save money in one area and you have to spend it somewhere else. So it's your time. And if you're not great with time, you know, if time is a problem, you're probably better off buying new material. But that's my only caveat in this whole scenario. The material's normally pretty good, and normally ends up saving you a few quid in the long run. Okay, I think I'm gonna leave the video there for this episode. This is kind of one of the videos I'm gonna link in the playlist for the hammers that I've been making recently. I'm gonna start covering in detail, sort of like a little bit more advanced stuff that most people tend not to share when they're making content to do with hammers, as sort of the pitfalls, where you can go wrong, how to make your hammers better. I'm gonna work on that. I'm gonna hand forge a hammer as well. I'm also gonna do a heat treat video at some point and a handling video. I think I may have done them in the past, but I don't know whether or not I did them with this camera, and I can't remember if they were any good or not. So what I'm gonna do is I'm probably gonna remake some of those. So thank you for joining me. Hopefully you enjoyed this video. If you did, please leave a like and subscribe if you haven't already. If you are a subscriber, ring that bell for notifications. It'll tell you every time I make a video. I'm trying to make 2 to 3 a week at the minute, and we're doing quite well. The last couple of weeks have been really, last 4 or 5 weeks, we've had 2 out every week for the last 4 or 5 weeks, and it's going really well. You guys are loving it, so thank you for joining me. And if you would like to support the channel in any way, shape or form, there's a few ways you can do that. Well, the first thing you can do is subscribe or chuck a comment down in the description, or even share this video with your friends on Facebook and do all that nice stuff. That's a great way to help the channel. Another way you can help the channel is you can go over to my Instagram and follow me there, and then you'll get some extra content. You'll know what's coming up as it's coming up for you guys and girls at home to enjoy. And there is one other way you can, well, there's a couple of other ways, but one other way I'm going to tell you about now is to go over to my Etsy. Go and check out the Etsy. There is everything from t-shirts to tong blanks to hammers, everything and anything you can think of about blacksmithing. I probably have made it, and it has probably been up there at some point in time. So go and check that out as well. Go and buy something. It would be a great way to help me support the channel and support this place. Right, I think I'm going to leave it there for this video. Hopefully you did enjoy it. I've really, 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 really enjoyed making this one. It's been great fun. So, I'm going to leave it at that. I'm going to leave a link up here. This is what YouTube thinks is best for you from my back catalogue. This here is the most recent video. And this one here is a video that I think you might like indeed. And there's a subscribe button there. Thank you for joining me. Goodbye. Bye-bye.